So thank you for everybody that have participated so far. Natalia, that was a great testimony. The music has been great. It's been a good Sabbath, right? And right after church, what do we have after church? Great lunch. That's always good. So we are in our last series on the book of Revelation called The Last Word. And I'm so glad that you're here. A lot of people are away already, so they won't be getting the last two sermons, this Sabbath and next Sabbath. And as I was thinking about that, I thought to myself, those that are seated here, you're truly the wise of the wise. Because people go away, and I don't understand why. If you live in paradise, where do you go to? It's just downhill, right? Now, next week, we will have the remnant of the wise that will be here. So be a part of that group next week. But we're here speaking about the last word, and this has been a journey that we've gone through. So today, we're going to talk about Revelation chapter 17 and 18, called The Beauty, the Beast, and the Babylon Goes Boom, right? The fall of these three. And last week, if you remember, I gave a big outline of the book of Revelation, and we're in this last section here that's basically the fulfillment of the first section, and we're going down, and today we're still in that section there where God's final wrath has been unmixed with his mercy. We already saw that God sent some judgments in order to redeem, but now God is saying enough is enough, and he's answering the prayers of his people to say, Lord, when will you do something? And so this is the answer of that, and so we're looking at that. So just a very quick recap if you haven't been here, or just to refresh your memory, Revelation chapter 12 is where we start the prophetic section in the book of Revelation. So Revelation chapter 12 is about the cosmic conflict, and there's four episodes there. Firstly, Satan tries to attack God and has war in heaven. He doesn't succeed. God wins. Then he tries to attack Jesus when Jesus is born. He doesn't win, right? God wins there. Then he tries to attack God's people throughout history. Who wins? Not the devil, right? God's people are victorious. And then the last episode is basically the last generation, the last people that will live on earth right before the second coming. Satan goes again and tries to attack them with great fury. Is he going to win? Once again, Scripture shows to us that those that are faithful to God, God will protect them, right? And then so we saw in Revelation chapter 13, God revealing more about this plan of attack that will happen with the last end day people. And the Revelation chapter 13 is basically about Satan and his cronies, the three individuals or the false trinity that will seek to coerce under duress, force people to do something or deceive them to follow the beast or the dragon. And then Revelation chapter 14, Robbie spoke about the interlude. So as the book of Revelation is explaining the war and those that will be participating in the war, the evil that will be participating, there's this interlude that speaks about God's people, the 144,000. So as we said during this time, this is not the first time that there's an interlude. God speaks about the 144,000, the church militant that will be fighting against the evil that is being shared in the world. And that one of the ways that that is being shared is by the three angels' message. The first angel says that we need to worship God, our Creator and our Redeemer. The second one is that says the second angel is Babylon is fallen. The third angel is the warning of the mark of the beast. And then we see that there's the patient endurance. Those that will make it are those that keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. And then there's a harvest. And I like the way that Robbie put it. He said there's eventually two cups and two camps. The one is that you will be faithful to God, to the covenant that he has given to you, and you'll be saved. Or the other camp is the unfaithful, and you will be lost. And essentially, friends, that's at the base where we all are. We need to choose which camp do we want to go into. Which camp do we decide on? Which cup do we drink from? From God's cup or from the dragon's cup? And so last week, we looked at Revelation chapter 15 and 16, the holy havoc of just judgment, where God is now busy pouring out the last plagues on the people, where he says, enough is enough. I will not continue to let my people be oppressed. And God is stepping in as the just judge. And so we went through those six plagues. And the last plague, plague number six, the drying up of Euphrates, if you remember it's back to the story of Babylon, the way that Babylon fell was that Media Persia came and they diverted the Euphrates. So what we're going to talk about today in chapter 17 and 18 is essentially explaining more of the last plague, plague number six, drying up of Euphrates, and plague number seven. And I haven't read that, so we're going to read that now. Revelation chapter 16 says, the seventh angel poured out his bowl into the air, and a loud voice came out of the temple from the throne room saying, it is done. Now, where have you heard this phrase, it is done, or it is finished? at the cross, right? And so we get this, what they call intertextual connection, where it says that God is saying, it is done. Finally, my wrath has been fully poured out onto this world. The work of redemption, the work of God coming and cleansing the world of evil is getting to a point where it's getting finished. And so the fall of evil will now occur. And there was flashes of lightning, rumbling, peals of thunder, and great earthquakes such as there has never been since man was on the earth. As I said last week, there's a storm coming relentless in its fury. There's certain things, the intensity and the volume will be turned up to such a degree that we have not experienced this in this world yet. So great was that earthquake. The great city was split into three parts, and the cities of the nations fell, and God remembered Babylon the Great to make her drain the cup of the wine of the fury of his wrath. And every island fled away, and no mountains were to be found, and great hailstones, about 100 pounds each, 45 kilograms, imagine that, coming down, fell from heaven on the people, and they cursed God for the plague of the hail, because the plague was so severe. So here we see, once again, sending these things does not lead them back to God. They only curse God. There's a saying that says, the same sun that melts butter also hardens clay. And so it is not necessarily the sun that's different. It's the way that you receive that. God can melt your heart, or you can harden your heart towards God. It's your choice what you do with your heart and the message that God sends. These individuals hardened their heart towards God. And so now we step into Revelation chapter 17 and 18 that exposes and explains this a little bit more. What does this mean about the fall of these things? Now, just very quickly and very briefly, I'm not going to go through the whole chapter 17 and the whole chapter 18. I'm just going to allude to some parts that I think would be important for us, because I pray that all of us, this message is not for us, because we will be part of the redeemed and the saints, right? So this is the message, for a warning for those that have not listened. But essentially, chapter 17 and chapter 18 can be broken up in various sections. Firstly, there's an introduction of the vision in chapter 17, verse 1 and 2. Then it's the vision of the great prostitute sitting on a beast. And then the rest of the chapter from 17 all the way to the end is basically explaining the vision. Now, once again, we have spoken about this idea in biblical prophecy of where God expands certain things, repeat and enlarge. So God explains something in Daniel chapter 2. And then he builds on that in Daniel chapter 7, Daniel chapter 8, Daniel chapter 9, Daniel chapter 11, 10 to 12. And then when we get to chapter 12 and 13, right, he keeps on building on the same prophecy. And so what we see here, if you read the explanation of the vision, you'll be like, but I've seen this before. This is not new information. When you've been through all of these prophecies, you'll know what this is talking about. You know who the beast is, right? And so when we get to Revelation chapter 18, we see the announcement of Babylon's fall, the lamentation over Babylon's fall. And you see there's a call to God's people, once again, to say, come out. There's a call for us that might still be in Babylon today, to say, come out of Babylon. And then there's a cry of the kings and the merchants and the sailors of what they have lost. And then there's a celebration of the saints that God is finally listening to their prayers. And then there's judgment and destruction of Babylon. That's the end of the evil and confusion. So here's the first takeaway. The first takeaway is God's prophetic prediction proves to be true. If you've been through us on this journey through the book of Daniel and Revelation, you know that these prophecies build on each other, and this prophecy is actually just a fulfillment of previous prophecies. If you go back to chapter 14, it says, another angel, a second, followed, saying, fallen, fallen is Babylon. God is giving predictive prophecy and saying, it is going to fall. So 17 and 18 is merely articulating what God had already predicted. He says, this is how it's going to happen. She who made all the nations drink of the wine of the passion of her sexual immorality. Now, a prostitute, what does a prostitute do? Well, she's a merchant in sexual immorality. And so, once again, just building on the same themes and same ideas. And another angel, a third, followed them, saying with a loud voice, if anyone worships the beast and its image and receives a mark on his forehead or in his hand, he also will drink of the wine of the wrath of God. So here we see the second and the third angel is Babylon is fallen and the warnings against the mark of the beast. Now, quick question. If you remember to our sermon in Revelation chapter 14, what is at the crux of the three angels' message? The idea of worship, right? The first angel was worship the Creator God, and the second one is Babylon is fallen and don't worship, right? At the heart of this whole conflict is this idea of worship. And so when we get to this God's prophetic prediction proves to be true, we have to say to ourselves, How far are we in this timeline? And how are we aligning up to the truth that is in Scripture? Are we following God? Are we foolish enough to just throw this wise words to the wind? We say, that doesn't affect me. That's not the reality that I'm going to live. It's not the world that I live in, because you, when you say that, are foolish. God had predicted certain things of church, of earth history, which have come true, and this will come true as well. Now, when we look at chapter 17, we see that there's an introduction to this vision. It says, "Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls came to me and said, 'Come, I will show you the judgment of the great prostitute.'" Right? So here we speak about the judgment that is happening with those who sit on many waters. Now, when we see in the same chapter, it actually explains to us what the waters are. Verse 15 says, "And the angel said to me, 'The waters that you saw where the prostitute is seated, peoples, multitudes, nations, and languages.'" Now, this idea of a woman and that constitute people and nations and languages is something that we see in Scripture all the time, right? This great prostitute is essentially just a church. In Revelation chapter 12, we see a church, blameless and pure, dressed in white. And now we see the opposite of that, one that has fallen for the adulteries of the world. Now, this idea of adultery or spiritual fornication is not a new idea. It's something that's already deeply embedded in Scripture, not just apocalyptic literature, but in all of Scripture. If you read, for instance, in James chapter 4, it says, "You adulterous people." James speaking to the church and says, you Christians, you're adulterous. Why? What have we done? And he says, "Do you not know that your friendship with the world is enmity with God? You are forsaking your husband, and you're fornicating yourself." You remember the story in the Old Testament where Hosea was called to go and get a woman. And God says, "Hosea, you're a prophet." And prophets, their work is to speak truth. And God says, "You're not going to just preach with your mouth, you're going to preach with your life." And how will you preach? Go and find a prostitute woman and take her to be your wife. Make a covenant with her that you will love her and care for her as your wife. And he goes and he gets this woman and he makes the covenant, eternal covenant with her, that "I will be your husband." She makes a covenant with him. And then, not long after that, what does she do? She goes back to the marketplace of sin. She goes back and prostitutes herself. And God says what to her? "Go again, Hosea. Go find the one that you love and bring her back." And then God says, "Because this is what Israel has done to me. They have been an adulterous nation. They have moved away. I am the one that have called them in. I am the one that have redeemed them from slavery. I am the one that gave them identity. They are created in my image. And yet they have adulterated themselves. Yet they have gone out and prostituted themselves with paganism, with false ideas." And here we come to the end of Revelation, and God says, "The history of Israel is the history for us." We still do the same thing. We still substitute the things of the world for the things of God. "Therefore, whoever wishes to be my friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God." Paul says the same thing in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 2. He says, "For I feel divine jealousy for you." Paul is speaking to the church and he says, "I feel this divine jealousy for you since I betrothed you to the one husband to present you as a pure virgin to Christ." That is what he has brought us. He's saying there is this marriage that has happened between the church. And so when we see the picture of this prostitute, we need to think to ourselves that this is not a woman that's an atheist. This is not a person that says that "I'm not a believer." This is somebody that confessed Jesus' name at one point. It's somebody that says that "I follow Jesus." They read their Bibles at one point. They came to church. They sang worship songs at one point. These are not individuals that say, "I don't believe in God. I want nothing to do with God." These are believers that have been deceived by the beast. These could be individuals like you and me that are not deeply rooted in Scripture ourselves. He continues, John says, "With whom the kings of the earth have committed sexual immorality." Sexual immorality is just a euphemism for this idea, or this metaphor for the idea of mixing and breaking of covenant, mixing of false ideas and breaking of covenant. "And with the wine of whose sexual immorality the dwellers on the earth have become drunk." And so we see this idea where there are certain people constructing certain ideas, whether it is political or secular or religious, bringing them together, using various forms of working together to essentially bring about this false type of worship, and the multitudes follow. The multitudes, either under duress or under the deception, follow the false and pagan worship. So here we see the vision now in verse 3. And he carried me away in spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sitting on a scarlet beast. Now I want you to pay attention here. This woman represents a false church, apostatized church, right? Now she sits on what? A scarlet beast. Now, if you've been with us on this journey for a while, have we seen a beast before? Yeah, in Revelation chapter 13, we saw a land beast and a sea beast, right? Now, there was a beast here. Now, this beast is different. It says a scarlet beast. Now, have we seen a scarlet beast before? No, we haven't seen a scarlet beast before. We've seen a red dragon before. Now, red and scarlet, very similar. Close in color, right? So here we see a beast. Now, this beast was full of blasphemous names, and it had 7 heads and 10 horns. Now, where have we seen a beast? Forget about the scarlet for a moment, but have we ever seen a beast that was full of blasphemous names that had 7 heads and 10 horns? Have we seen this before? Yes, in Revelation chapter 13. Who was that? Right? Let's read it. Revelation chapter 12 says, "And another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns, and on his heads 7 diadems. So now it's speaking about a dragon, right, with 7 heads and 10 horns. Then in Revelation chapter 13, we read about a beast rising out of the sea and 10 horns and 7 heads. Very similar. And then it says, with 10 diadems on its horns and blasphemous names on its head. And then it says, did I have that verse there? I don't have the verse there, but if you read on, it actually explains the composition of this beast. Now, what we said in Revelation chapter 13 is that essentially there's a counterfeit trinity. The dragon tries to be like God the Father, the sea beast tries to be like the Son, and the land beast tries to work like the Holy Spirit. The sea beast essentially points towards the land beast points towards the sea beast, like the Holy Spirit points toward Jesus. What does Jesus do? Jesus says in John chapter 17, "If you've seen me, you've seen the Father." He says, "I am in you and you are in me. I have come to reveal the Father." So essentially, the counterfeit Christ, the sea beast, represents and shows the dragon. But here's the interesting thing. When you go to Revelation 13, he looks similar to the dragon, but not exactly like the dragon, right? If there's a picture, now this is pictorially shown. If you look at Revelation chapter 12, there's a beautiful woman, the church, that's being attacked by a dragon. Then if you look at chapter 13, this is the picture that we get. 7 heads, so the lion, what does the lion represent? Babylon, right? The bear, Medo-Persia, right? The four leopard heads, Greece, right? And then we have Rome. And then the 10 horns are those that come out of Rome, right? This is Daniel prophecies that we've gone through. Now, when you look at this, you're like, okay, this is a beast that's similar but not exactly the same. These are all building upon, once again, Daniel chapter 2, Daniel chapter 7, Daniel chapter 8. These aren't new prophecies. These are prophecies that are repeated and enlarged, repeated and enlarged, repeated and enlarged. Now, when we go to the story that we're reading here, we will see that that beast is not the dragon. It's the beast that we found in Revelation chapter 13. But this beast is now scarlet, which means the beast has become more like the dragon. When we got to from chapter 13 to chapter 17, the beast has devolved into something more ferocious and more evil than what it started off as. So here's the takeaway. You become who you follow. You become who you follow. By beholding, you become changed. Who you follow essentially will form who you are. So the question is, who do you follow? Who's the one that you follow in your spiritual walk? Who's the one that you emulate? Who's the one that you want to be like? Who's the one that you follow as a disciple? The beast became like the dragon. There's some deep implication here for us to really reflect on what are the things that we image our lives after. What do we keep on beholding? Because whether you like it or not, whether you believe it or not, this is true reality. What you look at most of the time will essentially be the thing that you will become into. What you follow, or you become who you follow. We continue in verse 4. It says, "The woman arrayed in purple and scarlet and adorned with gold and jewels and pearls, holding her hand and a golden cup full of abominations, impurities of sexual immorality. And on her forehead was written a name of mystery, Babylon the Great, mother of the prostitutes of the earth's abomination." Now, another question I want to pose to you. This woman, is she a religious or a secular power or entity? Religious, right? She's a religious, she's a church. a fallen, apostatized church, but yet a church. So it's in within the religious realm. Now, is there another thing in Scripture that you can think of that connects a religious figure that is arrayed with purple and scarlet, adorned with gold and jewels and pearls, that has a cup or uses a cup and has something written on their forehead? Is there something in Scripture, another being, another entity, another thing that you can think of that is in a religious realm that has something like that? Connected to worship specifically. Something like the high priest in the Old Testament. That's an image of a high priest. Something written on his head. Beautiful stones amongst him on his chest. Written, wearing fine linen. Once again, he is a counterfeit of somebody leading people into worship. Yes or no? Right? Somebody leading people into worship. So this woman, as she leads them into false worship, she's trying to mimic the work of the high priest and the work of people that are supposed to intercede for them. And I saw the woman drunk with the blood of the saints and the blood of the martyrs of the church. But this religious person that's supposed to be a mediator to bring people to God has apostatized and now is oppressing God's people. And when I saw her, I marveled greatly. The second takeaway is that the battlefield is in the mind. The battlefield is in the mind. Essentially, if you think about this worship element, this worship problem that we have in this cosmic battle, essentially starts in your mind. What you believe, what you accept, because your mind dictates everything else that you do. And today, more and more, we have a problem with this idea of doubt that is creeping in. If you look at Genesis chapter 3, this is how the devil came. This is the place where he fought the first warfare. The first battle that was fought was at the level of the mind. In Genesis chapter 3, when Satan goes to Eve, he goes to her and she disobeys. And we generally, when we think about sin, when we think about transgression and fall and all of these things, we think of the action that she committed. We think of behavior. But behavior was stemmed from something else, right? Firstly, he came to doubt with her mind. He said, did God actually say? When he approached her, the first thing that he wanted to do is get her to disassociate with her current reality. Her current reality was that God had created her good, put her in a beautiful garden, made her as a kingdom of priests, put her there, and gave her everything to eat except the one tree. Then the devil came and he brought doubt to her and said, did God actually say? It brings doubt to her mind, and when she starts doubting, she eventually starts desiring with her heart something that was illicit that he had made illicit. God had given her licit desires, good desires, things that are beautiful, things that taste good. And he said, but you can eat of this fruit. And so by the illicit desires that was desired to become evil, she then partakes of the fruit, and then she disobeys with her hand. Now, if you drive down to this idea of doubt with the mind, you will see that at the heart of it, the devil wanted to bring doubt to God's word, to God's truth, because essentially he wanted to bring doubt to God's goodness. At the heart of the great controversy, there's an idea that God is not good. And the whole story of God is God showing that he is truly good. And the greatest picture of God showing that he is good is Jesus on the cross. The Almighty, all-powerful, creator God that keeps the universe in the span of their hand, the one that has always existed, the one that has life original, unborrowed, and underived, becomes a little baby, walks on this earth, garbs himself with humanity, and dies on a cross for your sins and for my sins. Not because he did anything wrong, because we did something wrong. And there on the cross, the great exchange happens. And God reveals his true glory. God's true glory is not through pomp and power, sitting on a throne, although he does sit on a throne, and although he has power. God says that his glory will be seen, not in how highly he is lifted up, but how much he will serve. Because that's the God that we worship, a God that thinks of others first. And there on the cross, you see the greatest glory of God ever. And he reverses the idea that God is not good. But the devil continues with this lie through the beast, the land beast and the sea beast, to keep on deceiving people that God is not good. And so we perpetually are still inundated by deception that God is not good. And so today we are wrestling with this idea of truth. John chapter 17, Jesus says, sanctify them by truth. Your word is truth. Today there's an attack on truth. There's an attack on truth in the world that we live in. More and more we are drifting away from this idea of what is truly true. Now I want to just briefly speak about this idea of the implications for theology. Now there's many domains that we can speak about this idea of attack on truth. But essentially this is what the prostitute does. She draws people away from truth. She draws people away from true reality. And she deceives them with falsity. And so we need to have our eyes and minds open to understand what truth is. Now, for those of us that are Christians, obviously the theological aspect of it is very important. Because the kernel of the idea of the great controversy is about God's goodness, essentially the heart of the problem of the great controversy is a theological idea. Yeah? Now, when I say theological, most people today feel that they're not theologians, and they should not care themselves about theology, right? But I want to reassess that idea in your mind by looking at just a few things about theology and the importance of theology. So theology literally just means the study of God. A lot of words are made from Greek words. For instance, theology is just a Greek word, theos plus logos, logos meaning discourse or the study of or the word of, right? So Jesus, when he says in John chapter 1, when John says Jesus is the word, he says, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. That word, word, is the word logos. He's the discourse. He's the understanding of. So when we get to theology, it literally means that the study or the understanding or the word of God. For instance, cardiology is made up of cardia, which means heart in Greek, and logos, the discourse. Or ophthalmology, the study of the eye. Ophthalmos is the Greek word for eye, and logos is the discourse. So theology at the heart of it is the speaking about God. Now, quick question. How many in this room has ever said anything about God ever before? Yeah, all of us have, right? All of you have said something about God, which means all of you have done theology. The question isn't if you're doing theology. The question is, are you doing good theology? We all do theology. Even atheists do theology. Every person that says something about God, everybody that makes an assertion about God is saying something about that is a theological statement, right? Karl Barth, one of the most popular and most influential theologians of the 20th century, said this. He says, in the Church of Jesus Christ, there can and should be no non-theologians. When you open your Bible and you read your scriptures and you say certain things and have a conversation about the Bible, you are doing theology. So the question we have to ask ourselves, am I doing good theology? Right? Am I doing good theology? Because essentially the warfare is about the idea, the theological idea about God's goodness. How do you know God is good? How do you know what is true and what is false about God? Well, you only know that through Scripture. So you're doing theology, right? Now, I just want to balance that off in case you get the idea that theology is all about the mind. Paul David Tripp says this. He says, the church is not a theological classroom. So when you come to church, you're not merely doing theology in terms of just getting information. No. It is a conversion. It's a confession. It's a repentance. It's a reconciliation, forgiveness, and sanctification center where flawed people, that's you and me, place their faith in Christ, gather to know and love him better, and to learn to love others as he has designed. Essentially, this is what he's saying. He's saying theology is not merely a mental exercise. It is more than that, but it's not less than that. You understand that? Coming to church and being a Christian involves theology, but it is not merely a mental exercise. It is the application of what you get when you read the scriptures, and formulate your theology. So what is theology, right? There's basically three branches. Now, there's many different branches within theology, but essentially, there's biblical theology, systematic theology, and practical theology. So biblical theology is when you read the Bible. So for instance, you're studying the book of Matthew, right? That's New Testament theology. Or you're reading the book of Exodus. That's Old Testament theology. And you're studying what Moses said in Exodus. You're trying to figure out what is Mark saying to you about Jesus and how does that relate to what Matthew said about Jesus. You are doing biblical theology. But then you don't just stick with biblical theology. What you do is you need to apply that and articulate what you learn from that. Because as you read your Bible, as you go through it, you're obviously formulating ideas and beliefs. That's systematic theology. Systematic theology is the articulation of beliefs in a systematic form or in a system. What does that mean? Our church has 28 fundamental beliefs. That's a systematic theology. So somebody comes to you and says to you, can you tell me about the Trinity? You're like, yeah. Let's go to John chapter 1. and you read a few verses in John, and then you say, hey, let's jump to Hebrews, and then let's go to Genesis, and then let's go to Revelation, and let's go to James. What you're doing is you're jumping around the Bible, and you're looking at a topic, the Trinity. So what you're doing in your biblical theology, you have looked at these passages, studied these passages, and now you draw them together in a system so that you can speak about God, the Godhead, or you can speak about Jesus and his salvation, or you can speak about the priesthood, you can speak about various topics. That's systematic theology. Practical theology is when you start practically applying certain things. For instance, how do I do evangelism? How do I give a Bible study, right? Or how must I be a better steward? What are the biblical principles of being a good steward? That's when you look at the biblical theology and draw once again from that practical ways of living. Now, we all do this all the time. We all read the Bible and formulate beliefs, and we all do practical things about that. So once again, the question isn't, are you doing systematic theology? Are you doing biblical theology? Are you doing practical theology? We all do it. The question once again is, are you doing it well enough? Now, as most of us, if there's a domain that we get into, it's a domain that we have to learn certain things. I'll give you a really good example of something. A few years ago, some of us in this church got into cycling. Now, what I knew about cycling at that point is that I knew how to ride a bike. That's what I knew about cycling. I did not know the difference between a carbon fiber frame and an aluminium frame. I just knew they were different materials. But what they meant, I did know nothing of. And so when I started to get into cycling and started to think about buying a bike and all of these things, I started to research and think, because now I'm interested in it. This is a hobby that I'm interested in. And so now I'm starting to research. Now if you come to me and ask me about a bike, should I buy this bike or that bike? I can tell you the differences of frames. I can tell you the different components. I can tell you the levels of different components. I can tell you various things about this. Now this didn't happen overnight. This was a way of learning for me. Now, if you think about it, if at the heart of the great controversy is a theological idea, and Jesus consistently says that you need to be sanctified in truth and your word is truth, it means that we need to put some effort into studying theology. And if you don't have the skill set, it is good for us to learn more skill sets about theology. Now, the problem that we have today, and I say this with respect, is that we think we know enough. We think that we already do this, and so we stop doing this. Mark Knoll, a historian of the intellectual history of evangelical church, says this, the scandal, and this, his book is called The Scandal of the Evangelical Mind. He's not just speaking about Adventists here, but anybody that's a Protestant evangelical, which is us. He says, the scandal of the evangelical mind is that there is not much of the evangelical mind. He's an intellectual historian. He looks at the intellectual history as it develops, and he says he's looked at Protestantism, and we were formidable forces in the intellectual world. Some of the greatest thinkers were Christians. But today, we see less and less of those. Why is that? Could it be that we have not put ourselves to the point where we keep on studying, keep on learning, keeping our minds fresh? Ellen White says the greatest things that we need to do with our youth is to train them to not be mere reflectors of other men's thoughts, but thinkers themselves. Are you an original thinker? Can you really think for yourself? Or do you think you can and you have this pseudo-intellectualism, but you are struggling? There's a spectrum of theology. Folk theology over here is this idea where you just accept certain theological views, certain things, and you think that you've thought them through, but a lot of your theology, a lot of the baggage that you hold is basically stuff that's not in the Bible. Let me give you an example. So for instance, we're very close to Christmas time. It's the Advent season, right? So in the Advent season, we normally speak about the three wise men. Have you ever heard of them, the three wise men, right? Is that biblical, yes or no? No. How many wise men were there? We don't know, right? We don't know how many. There were three gifts, but we don't know. There could be many, right? Now, a lot of people would say there's three wise men, so we're just going to follow that there's three wise men. Now, this is pretty harmless, but there's other things that people just accepted. This is reality. This is true, right? And so there's an idea of folk theology that is happening where we just accept ideas, accept certain things. Now, on the other spectrum of it, we have academic theology. Academic theology is when academics write to academics, right? That's like something where somebody would write on the migration patterns of the Bedouin sheep in the Second Temple Judaism. Who cares? Right? Nobody cares about that. And that's not going to change anything about my reading of the Bible. Right? What we need to do is we want to be somewhere between lay theology, means that you're not a professional theologian, but you take scripture seriously. You try and read Scripture with reverence and respect. You cultivate skills of learning, like you have to develop skills in anything else, cooking, driving a car, whatever it is. You learn skills of reading your Scriptures better and better each year, right? And then you draw on ministerial theology. Ministerial theology is when you're trained as a pastor. That's normally a bachelor's degree, right? But even pastors that are trained in theology, they generally trained in a variety of stuff, very, very surface level. Then you move to professional theology. Professional theology is people with master's or doctoral degrees that generally try and serve the church by digging deep into Scripture and then giving that to the church back. So what we can do as a reading community is say, I want to be not in folk theology where I just accept theological views, but I'm constantly rethinking my theological views, rethinking what I believe, and I'm actually an active thinker. Jesus said the way that you can love him is to love him with all of your heart, mind, and soul. So part of reading the Bible well and part of forming your mind theologically is an act of worship that you do towards God. Putting in the effort, doing the work. Ellen White writes often about how we need to not just have a surface reading of Scripture, but dig deep into the Bible. She speaks about mining for those truths, those jewels that are not on the surface, but that needs to be found. Now, I don't know if you've ever gone mining before, but it's a lot of work. In South Africa, there's a lot of mines, especially where I lived in Johannesburg. There's a lot of mines there. My dad used to work for a platinum mine as in the refinery, right? And those people, they know what mining is. It's a lot of effort. It's a lot of work. It doesn't just happen. You don't just walk around and be like, oh, there's a diamond over there. Great. Oh, platinum. Great. Oh, there's some, right? You have to work for it. But we have become so accustomed to getting everything on a platter that we don't work and fortify our mind with theology anymore. And so we come to church and we hear these things and we assent to these things. But when we are put on the hot seat, when somebody presses us for our beliefs, we don't know what we actually believe. Or we think that we know, but then when somebody comes with a different scripture, we're like, oh, I don't actually know how to interpret that or to say that. Now, it's okay not to know all the answers. I don't know everything either. I've been studying theology for a very long time. And I still read stuff when I'm like, I have no idea. That's why we have this reading community. That's why we come to church and go to Sabbath school. That's why we come to the elements of discipleship. That's why we come to small group, to talk about these things, say, I don't actually know what's going on here. Help me explain this. And as you articulate, as you are working together, you are strengthening your faith and you are deepening your understanding of true theology. Meredith Lace, speaking about Australia, she says this, biblical literacy is likely lower in Australia today than at any point since the convict era. This is in 2018 that she wrote this. General levels of familiarity with Christian scriptures are difficult to plot precisely, but the studies of the Bible reading habits and and data on various forms of Christian socialization indicate a significant decline in Australians' exposure to Bible over the last century. She's saying that people are not reading their Bibles anymore. We know this, right? The last census showed that Australia is what? 43% still Christian. She mentions a quote here that's quite funny to me in 2002. She says, a survey in 2002 surveyed that 29% of Australians or adults still read the Bible at least once a year, with 8% reading it frequently. George Barna did a recent study as well in America, or the Barna Group, and he said that only 4% of Americans, now America is a lot more Christian than Australia, 4% of Americans have an actual biblical worldview. What does that mean? It means that they what they read in Scripture, they inculcate into their lives. They live it out. They're not just saying, yeah, I believe these things and there's something differently. That's what it means to follow and believe true theology, because you will live what you truly believe. You can say whatever you want in Bible studies and small groups and all of these things, but the way you live your life is actually the way your theology comes out. And this is the way that the woman forced them away. This is the way that she deceives people, moves them away from their belief systems. Now, the sources of Scripture. How do we do theology, right? Now, we've spoken about that we need to do theology. I'm just going to briefly speak about how can we do this. There's basically four sources of theology, right? How you build your theological systems. One is Scripture. This is the most foundational, formative way of Scripture. I put it in caps so that you would understand that this is the norm. Scripture norms everything else, but there are other things. For instance, there is reason. When you read the Bible, you use your reason. Now, when you use your reason, you need to realize that your reason might be wrong. You do use tradition. When you read the Bible, we all bring tradition upon the text. And then we all have experiences. And our reason, our tradition, and our experience all form who we are when we read the text. But Scripture is supposed to be the one that norms that. What does that mean? That means that we should study the Scripture in a reading community, coming together constantly to check our beliefs. And so as we come together with different views, different traditions, different, we come together, and as we read, we draw on professionals as they study the Scriptures and help us on this journey, we come together as a strong reading community that dispel our biases and may hopefully get more in line with Scripture. Yeah? So as we come to Scripture, we need to realize that Scripture is a historical document, a literary artifact, and a theological communication from God to His people. That means that when you read the Bible, when you are doing theology, you're starting with that biblical theology, you're studying in the text, you need to realize that you're dealing with a text that was not written to you, but it is written for you. Right? God has a divine message in there, but it is written in a different ancient culture. So do you understand that culture? How much of that culture do you know? There's books and ways that you can learn, skills to learn that within the context. Then once again, right, a literary artifact. Within the text, there's certain things. How does the ancient language work? How does this literary device work? What does it mean when he says this? How does this connect with this, right? Think of yourself, the easiest way to understand it is you're a journalist, investigative journalist that's trying to figure out what's happening in this text. And you're using as many sources as you can, getting as many reliable evidences as you can to find out what the Bible is saying. And then it's theological communication. That's one of the most important. To know that you're not just reading that, once again, reading the Scriptures as merely a theological information-seeking process. But it's a way that you connect with God. So say to God, God, as I'm reading this, I'm trying to find out what are you trying to say to me. And as I dig into Scripture, may I be drawn into who you are. May I not only see your truth, but through your truth, see your goodness. You're trying to undo the deception of the devil, because as you go to his word, you're seeking his truth. And as you seek his truth, you will seek his goodness. Now, there is some problems that we still face today that is becoming greater and greater in our world. And that is the idea of the fact-value split, the expressive individualism, and then moral relativism, neo-pluralism, new tolerance, and deconstruction. Now, this is a lot of stuff to take in. I get this. And as I was preparing the sermon, I was thinking to myself, what do I preach on Revelation chapter 17 and 18? I can speak about the fall of Babylon, but most of us, I believe, are following Jesus. So this message about the fall, we've heard before. And so I want to articulate this very clearly if you haven't picked it up yet. The idea that I'm trying to get to your mind in the sermon is essentially the importance of knowing theology and the importance of knowing that there are certain trends and ideas that are being pushed in the world that is trying to deceive your reading of theology and understanding of theology or move you away from completely believing in God at all. So now that we've spoken about that theology is super important, it's at the core of the great controversy essentially about the theological articulation of who God truly is, his goodness, we need to understand of some of the deceptions that are happening. Now, these are not all of them, but these are some of the major ones that I see today. The first one is the fact-value split. The fact-value split essentially says that philosophically there's this move by naturalists and materialists, as it has been growing through many, many years, that there is a split within our society in the minds of people. This is an ideology. This is an idea that essentially the world is split into two spheres. The first sphere is the scientific or fact sphere. This sphere says that this is public, objective, and valid for everyone. For example, gravity is something that everybody agrees on. If somebody says, I don't believe in gravity, we'll be like, well, you're crazy, right? We would all say, that's science. It's true. How can you not believe in this? This is objectively true for everybody, whether you live in Australia, whether you live in South Africa, whether you live in India, whether you live in Norway. Doesn't matter where you are. This is true for everybody, whether you believe it, whether you like it. It doesn't matter. It's objectively true for everybody. And everybody would agree. But then when we get to the spiritual sphere or the value sphere where theology and morality works, people say, no, there's a difference. This is private, this is subjective, and this is relativistic. Which means that you believe this, and that's your value system. And you believe this, and that's your value system. But that's just that. That's your value system. That's not objective. That's subjective. The fault with this is that truth is truth, regardless, right? So there's certain things that's objectively true. Thank you, Barry. There's certain things that are, that's objectively true. For instance, somebody would say that that believing in Jesus as your Savior is a value statement. That's your value statement. But let's think about this, the logic of that. Either Jesus existed or he didn't exist, right? Either there was a man like Julius Caesar or Julius Caesar didn't exist. Either there was a guy like Hitler or there wasn't a guy like Hitler. Like historically, there were certain people that existed. So the question is, was there a man like Jesus that truly existed, yes or no? Well, there's historical evidence that says that there was a man like Jesus. Now, if you look at the evidence and keep on digging up the evidence, you'll see that this, what this man said, as C.S. Lewis has famously said, that you would either come to Jesus and listen to the stuff that this historical man said, and you'll come away with three conclusions. One, he is a liar. Two, he's a lunatic. Or three, he's the Lord. And when you go through more evidence, you will see that it hinges upon his resurrection. The resurrection is one of the most important things that gives us credence to our faith. Paul even said so. If it wasn't for the resurrection, our faith would be in vain. So once again, when you start digging through the evidence, you will see that Jesus had resurrected. Now, some people say, but that's a value system. You say, no, there's no values there. It's a historical reality, and because of that historical reality, therefore we accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Therefore, we accept the morals that he gives to us. This is sometimes called the total truth system. Francis Schaeffer was one of the first apologists that would speak about this. And he engaged in Switzerland. He's an American that lived in Switzerland. And he engaged with a lot of New Age, non-believers, all of the. And he constantly would say to them, this is the problem that we face today, this fact-value split. Because when you start a conversation with people, they automatically want to move like that's a value discussion and this is a fact discussion. So we need to, in our minds, start to say, no, God's truth is truth over all of the universe. God is truth. God's truth is both moral and scientific, right? God is the God that created the laws of the universe. So when there's gravity, that's God's truth. The second law of thermodynamics, that's God's truth. The truth that we should keep the Sabbath is God's truth. It's objectively true for all people everywhere. Right? And so once again, we need to come to this and say, what are the things that shape my mind and what is the cultural trends that are happening now that is using as a deception that's moving away? Because one of the things that's happening is that we are unhinging ourselves, we are untethering ourselves from God and his truth, and that will eventually lead to more relativism. And relativism means it's true for you, but it's not true for me. So who's to say what is actually true? So we will go anywhere we want to go as long as it pleases me. The next one is expressive individualism. Yuval Levin in The Fractured Republic writes this about expressive individualism. He says, the term suggests not only a desire to pursue one's own path, but also a yearning to fulfillment through the definition and articulation of one's own identity. He's saying that I want to follow my own way. I want to say this is where I want to go, and this is why I do it, because I am this person. I have decided that this is my reality. This is my identity. This is my belonging. This is my purpose in life. He continues, he says, it is a drive both to be more like whatever you already are and also to live in a society by fully asserting who you are. The capacity of individuals to define their own terms of their own existence by defining their own personal identities is increasingly equated with the liberty, with the freedom, and with the meaning of some of our basic rights, and it is given pride of place in our self-understanding. What is he saying? Essentially, expressive individualism is this. Before the 1500s, because the 1500s, 1600s, this is when the philosophical train started to move for these ideas to permeate and get to the point of where they are today. But before a certain time, people looked up to God for purpose, for identity, and for belonging. They looked up for God to say, God, who am I as your creature created in your image? What are you calling me to do? What is the purpose that you want for me in life? Where do I belong in society? And then they looked outside to their community and said, how do I live that reality in my community? Today, people look in to themselves and say, who am I? Let me decide who I am. Let me decide what my identity is, where I belong, what my purpose is. And then I look to the others, not to give input, but to accept who I am and to say, yes, that's who you are. And then if you are feeling spiritual, you will look up to God so that he can agree with you. That's essentially expressive individualism. The catchphrase would be, you be you, or you do you. Now, this does that sit a bit uncomfortable with you? This idea that you do you? We are so permeated with this idea, this is the water that we swim in, that this has become such a thing for us today that I need to forge my own way. I need to give myself my own identity. And what is he saying here? He says that it's equated with the liberty, the freedom. We are living in a world where more and more freedom will be, you just decide who you are. And at the heart of that is where you get to decide all of these things, is that you are the God of your own universe. You're the God that dictates what your identity is, what your belonging is, what your purpose is. It's a moving away from God. These two things, the fact, value splitting, and expressive individualism, gives rise to various things, and they kind of form into each other. First one is moral relativism, where essentially because you get to decide everything and you get to decide what is right and what is wrong, and we come together and as a group we can decide what's right and wrong, the ethics become, what do we like? Essentially, feelings become at the heart of everything. So moral relativism says that there's no real thing that's wrong or right. We get to decide as human beings, or you get to decide what's right and wrong, and as long as it doesn't hurt anybody. The next one is new pluralism. Pluralism has always been there. We've seen it in Scripture all the time, different nations living with each other. But the new pluralism is different. New pluralism works like this. In the ancient, say, ancient East, there were people, say, in China or in those places that would be Hindus and Taoists and various really Buddhists, and they would live together. Now, if you went at a certain time and you said to them that you're a Hindu, right? And they would say, yes, this is my belief system. And they said, well, next to you lives a Taoist. You get along. You're like, you're living in a pluralistic society. You get on with each other. He says, yes. But if you go into that person and said, well, is what he believes true? They would say, no. What I believe is true. Pluralism says that there's difference. New pluralism is a sort of where we accept certain things and bring it in. So I want a little bit of Hinduism. I want a bit of Eastern mysticism. I want a bit of Christianity. So we get to decide our religious system. And we take from all of these different sources and we construct God in our image. And I let you construct God in your image. But once again, logically and morally, that doesn't make any sense. Because either Hinduism is true, or Christianity is true. They're mutually exclusive because they say different things. Christianity says the only way of salvation is through Jesus. Hinduism says that there's another way to salvation. Buddhism say there's another way of salvation. So each of these things say different things, so they cannot all be true, logically speaking. The other one there, the new tolerance. Tolerance is something that is a good virtue to have, and I've spoken about this before. Tolerance is this idea that we come together and we believe that there is objective truth. And because there is objective truth, we come together and we don't agree on what that objective truth is. And in the pursual of objective truth, we come together and we enter into a discussion, a discourse. And as we talk to each other, we are both seeking to bring the best arguments of what we believe to be true. And as we articulate and explain what we believe to be true, we hope that is convincing to the other person and that we come closer to truth. Now, in that process, you hopefully will learn something, and maybe you learn that you were right or you learn that you were wrong and you adjust yourself. But essentially, at the heart of tolerance is this idea that there is an objective truth. New tolerance says that your truth is your truth and my truth is my truth, which means that if your truth is not in line with my truth, just accept my truth. Essentially, once again, illogical, because it says that I have to accept your truth to be true. Can you see how confusing and logically incoherent this is, these systems? And essentially, at the heart of all of them is the question of objective and subjective truth. Is there something that is true outside of what you determine what is true or what is false? And then the last one there is deconstruction, something that we see more and more of today. Many Christians deconstructing their faith. Deconstructing what they believe in. I want to read this quote from a woman. Now, deconstruction is something that comes from the postmodern philosophers, specifically Jacques Derrida. And the idea of deconstruction, actually, if you've ever read them, they're very confusing to read, and most of the time they don't make any sense. And that's the point. They're not supposed to make sense. You're supposed to give it sense, right? And one of the interesting thing about Jacques Derrida's thing is that he constantly, through the deconstruction of text, you bring meaning to the text, and each meaning can be different. And the point of it is to break down power hierarchies. That's the point of it. Now, people have latched onto that in Christianity, and they've started to deconstruct their faith. This is what Melissa Stewart says. Now, this Melissa Stewart has deconstructed her faith, and she ran a Twitter page with hundreds of thousands of people that followed her with a hashtag ex-evangelical, right? And she was on a podcast, ex-evangelical. And this is what she said after she's interviewed thousands and thousands of these people that have deconstructed their faith, right? She says this. She says, "My biggest experience with it were people were talking about it, what they went through, their stories, and it was very personal, and it focused on the human beings who have come out of this, rather than on whether a certain kind of theology is right or wrong." What is she saying, essentially? People, as they were deconstructing, I'm not saying everybody, but she says in the conversation, she realized that people were talking about their stories. Now, stories are important. Our stories are important. Our experiences are important. As I said, the sources of theology, experience is one of them. Your story is important, but your story should be in line with Scripture. You don't bend Scripture to be in line with your story. Yeah? And she's saying a lot of these people were working and they were essentially deconstructing their faith, but they weren't reconstructing it, trying to find out what is truly true. Alicia Childers says this about deconstruction. She also deconstructed her faith. She says this, "Deconstruction has little to do with objective truth and everything to do with tearing down whatever doctrine somebody believes is morally wrong." So at the heart of this question is that there is an attack on truth, attack on objective truth. And we live in a world where this attack is getting worse and worse. And when we think about the prostitute, when we think about the false deception that is coming, if we think about the counterfeit, we will all experience this attack on truth in our lives. And so how do we fight against that? Is to be sure that we have an anchor in Jesus and we are stable, living unto the written word, a living word and the written word. That we draw closer unto Jesus, our living word. And how do we know Jesus? By the written word. In the book of John, John writes to a second generation of Christians, people that have not seen or heard Jesus. And when you read about the purpose of John, he says, "I have written these things so that they might believe." This comes right off of the back of the story of Thomas that says that I want to touch Jesus and I want to feel him before I believe. And he says, "Blessed are those that have not seen yet believed." And then he says all of these things. And then later on in the end of the chapter, John says this in chapter 21. He says, "There are many things that I have written," or "there are many things that Jesus have said that could have been written down, but not all of them have been written down. But I have written these things so that you can believe." The point of John's gospel is this, that we get to know who Jesus is. We get to build our faith, and we can have a true living experience with Jesus through the written word. Because as we connect to the written word, we are connected to Jesus with the living word. The question is, are we doing that rightfully so? Are we coming in a reading community of believers, sitting and talking about Scripture, meditating on it, getting it in our mind, fortifying our mind so that when the deception comes, when the counterfeits come, we will not be confused. We will know they're coming and we will know what it's about. Now the question is, the attack on truth, where is the foundation? Where is the foundation of this? I want to read you something from one of the prophets of atheism. One of the prophets of atheism. This is one of the most, and I'm going to read it to you, so it's so well written. It's so beautifully written. It was written in 1883. Was anybody alive during that time? 1883. Is senior today? 1883. I want to read it to you. Friedrich Nietzsche writes this in Thus Spoke of the Zarathustra. He writes this. It's called The Madman. Maybe you've heard it before. Maybe you've just heard glimpses of it. Have you ever heard the phrase, "God is dead"? Right? By the atheist. God is dead. God is dead. It comes from this book. Now listen to this. This is a madman speaking. He says, "Have you not heard of that madman who lit a lantern in the bright morning hours, ran into the marketplace and cried incessantly, 'I seek God. I seek God.' As many of those who did not believe in God were standing around just then, he provoked much laughter. 'Has he got lost?' asked one. 'Did he lose his way like a child?' asked another. 'Or is he hiding? Is he afraid of us? Has he gone on a voyage? Maybe immigrated?' Thus they yelled and they laughed. The madman jumped into their midst and pierced them with his eyes. 'Whither is God?' he cried. 'I will tell you. We have killed him. You and I. All of us are his murderers. But how did we do this? How could we drink up the sea? Who gave us the sponge to wipe away the entire horizon? What were we doing when we unchained this earth from the sun? Whither is it moving now? Whither are we moving? Away from all of the suns? Are we not plunging continually? Backward and sideward, forward in all directions. Is there still an up and a down? Are we not straying as through an infinite nothing? Do we not feel the breath of empty space? Has it not become colder? Is not night continually closing in on us? Do we not need to light lanterns in the morning? Do we hear nothing as yet of the noise of the grave diggers who are burying God? Do we smell nothing as yet of the divine decomposition? God's too decompose. God is dead. And God remains dead. And we have killed him. How shall we comfort ourselves, the murderer of murderers? What was the holiest and the mightiest of all that the world has yet owned has bled to death under our knives. Who will wipe away this blood off us? What water is there for us to cleanse ourselves? What festivals of atonement and sacred games shall we have to invent? Is not the greatness of this deed too great for us? Must we ourselves not become gods simply to appear worthy of it? There has never been a greater deed, and whoever is born after us for the sake of this deed will belong to a higher history than all the history hereto. Yet the madman fell silent and looked again at his listeners, and they too were silent and stared at him in astonishment. At last, he withdrew his lantern on the ground and broke it into pieces and went out. I have come too early, he said. My time is not yet. This tremendous event is still on its way, still wandering. It has not yet reached the ears of men. Lightning and thunder require time. The light of the stars require time. Deeds, though done, still require time to be seen and heard. This deed is still more distant from then than most distant stars. And yet they have done it themselves. Here is an atheistic philosopher in 1883 predicting where we live today. He's saying that the concept of God, if it is killed, our world go into turmoil. And we live in a world now where people have untethered. The world is constantly untethering themselves from God. And if you untether yourself from the truth of truth, God himself, you will lead up to a world of subjectivity, relativity, pluralism, where you do you, and that means chaos, and that means Babylon, confusion. And so how do we fortify ourselves against this prostitute and this beast? By fortifying ourselves in the Word of God. Not a superficial reading of the Word of God, but a deep reading of the Word of God for ourselves in a reading community where we come together. Because I can tell you this, friends, if you are not rooted in Scripture, if you are not rooted in the Son, you will fall away. When the winds of strife come, you will struggle. When it is easy, when it is comfortable, let us get on our knees. Let us pray to the Holy Spirit to lead and guide us into all truth. Jesus himself made that promise. He says, I go away in John chapter 14. I go away, but I will not leave you as orphans. I will send you the Spirit. The Spirit of who? The Spirit of truth. And he will lead you into all truth. As we dig into Scripture, as we do theology, may we do it faithfully so that we can dispel the falsehoods of the world, the falsehoods of the devil, the falsehoods where we say, but this is not the Word of God, the truth of God, or anything related to the goodness of God. May we know what truth is, and may that truth set us free. Amen.